All right, gang, we really are done with chapter 5. The only thing that was left was talking about formatted print statements, which we've already done. And they give a fancy example of it where you define your format string before you use it. But we know how to parse this. Minus 25s, the minus just means left justified rather than right. 25 means it needs to be 25 spaces wide. S means that it's a string. And here's something that's going to be 13 spaces wide and another 13 spaces wide and something that's 15 spaces wide. And then for printing out the data rather than the heading, they also have it be 25 wide, 13, 13, and 15. They just made it so that the header and each line of data occupies the same number of spaces. Then we could print out the data. Or you'd have a loop that would step through something to generate the data and to print it out. We've done printfs before, we'll use them again. So what is the name of the class that contains these methods? Okay, that's pretty easy to guess.
Math.
The integer and wrapper classes are example of what? Wrapper classes. Because they wrap up the functionality of the primitive data types, int with a lowercase I, char with a lowercase c, and so on. The character class. To perform character-related operations, you use the character wrapper class. Like if you want to see if something is a digit, or it's a letter, or if it's uppercase or lowercase. Let's test that out before we hit chapter 6. Which lecture are we on?
Q.
Q. All right, thank you. So let's write a method that'll do some statistics on a string. It'll take that string and it'll count the number of uppercase letters and the number of lowercase letters and the number of digits and things like that. So public static void, just because it's not going to return anything, analyze parentheses string with a capital S. Now for every character in the string, I'm not actually sure this syntax is going to work. Let's find out. For char colon S, is that going to work? Nope. All right. Works in Java. Sorry. So instead, we're going to have to use an index-based loop. But anyways, let's define our counters. Int, you know, uppers equals 0, comma, lowers equals 0, comma, characters, you know, like letters, or how about just letters, equals 0, comma, digits equals 0, semicolon. And now we can have our for loop that's going to go through and analyze the string. So, for int I equals 0, semicolon, I's less than s dot length parentheses in parentheses, semicolon, I plus plus. Let's get that character out, and then we'll analyze it. What do we mean analyze? Well, if we go and look at the PowerPoint, you do character dot is uppercase, and you can specify the character. What I wonder, forgive me for experimenting for just a moment. Character ch, don't even type this, equals single quote b end quote. Can we just do ch dot is uppercase? Nope. Okay, we have to use the static methods of the class. Okay, so anyways, char space ch equals s. How do we get a specific character out of a string? We want to get a character just at a specific position. Oh, it's already there, right on screen. Char at, capital A, parentheses I, in parentheses, and now we can analyze that character. Like, what if it's a digit? If parentheses, and we're going to wind up typing this so often that we'll probably want to copy and paste it. Character dot is digit parentheses ch in parentheses. I guess I didn't take that long to type out. Then it's a number, right? Digits plus plus. In parentheses. Sorry, in braces. And we don't even really need the braces for this one. Right, because we only have one line of code we're executing there, so I'm going to remove the braces. But for letters, I may be a little bit more complicated. I may use braces. If character dot is alphabetic, parentheses ch in parentheses, that means it's a letter. Letters plus plus semicolon. But if it's a letter, we also care about whether it's lowercase or uppercase. So if character dot is lowercase, parentheses ch in parentheses, and add to the number of lowers, lowers plus plus semicolon. And then if parentheses character dot is uppercase, parentheses in parentheses, uppers plus plus. So this is the end of our for loop. I think we've done them all, right? Uppers, lowers, digits, and letters. Digits, letters, lowers, and uppers. That looks good, huh? Okay. So this is the end of our for loop right here. This is the end of our method. After the for loop, but before the end of the method, we need to print our data out. System.out.println, parentheses, quote, analyzed, space end quote plus s. And then one for each thing we've been tracking, digits and letters and so on. System.out.printf parentheses quote. Now these are ints, so what letter do, what placeholder do I use to represent an int? A float or a double is an f, but an int is a?
D.
Yep, D. Kind of wish it was I, it's not. D digits, backslash n, end quote, comma digits. And I think I'm just going to copy and paste that a couple of times so I can print out, three times to be precise, so I can print out the letters and the uppercase letters and the lowercase letters. Uppercase letters, lowercase letters, and then all letters. And I need to change the variable that's feeding the placeholder. So this is uppers, that's lowers, and that's letters. Oh, and I didn't call the function, so I don't get any output when I run it. So down in main, I need to call analyze. So down here inside main, let's just feed it a string. Analyze parentheses, this is a string to analyze. Cool beans. End quote, in parentheses, semicolon. Now there weren't any numbers in it. It had three uppercase letters, which sounds right. I remember capitalizing cool and beans and this. 28 lowercase letters. 31 all letters, good, those two things are added together. Let's add in some numbers. About 23 cool beans. There they are. Two digits. We're gonna have a homework assignment based on this idea. It's a classic homework assignment. Write a password analysis program that asks for a new password, and it has to meet some rules, like it has to be 8 characters long and have one uppercase letter, or at least one uppercase letter and one lowercase letter and one digit. Usually they ask for one special symbol too. How would you check to see if something was a special symbol? It looks something like this. I'm just running this off the top of my head, but if character dot is there something that means alphabet or digit? Is letter or digit? Yeah. So if character dot is letter or digit, parentheses ch in parentheses equals false, that means it's punctuation. Right? So we could add another counter if we wanted to count the number of punctuation.
Right.
We might want to make sure that there's no spaces in it, because you're only allowed to put in, you know, one word as your password, although several words might be, you know, safer, more difficult to guess. This space is space my space password 123 exclamation point would be pretty hard to guess. Anyways. Next chapter, object-oriented programming. What if we wanted to do this in a separate fashion? What if we wanted a class to hold this data? Now, normally my first object I make is something real simple, like a square that calculates the area, you know, and the perimeter or something like that. We'll do that too. But since we already have this concept fresh in our mind, let's make a class that does the same stuff. We're going to call it class string analysis. Open curly brace, close curly brace. And it needs some pieces of data. Same one. Int, letters, comma, digits. That's enough, right? Let's not go overboard. And it needs a place to hold the data. String space s equals, well, doesn't have any data yet, so let's just initialize it to empty quotes. Now we need a function to analyze. Doesn't need to return anything as far as I'm concerned, so I'm going to define it as type void. Void analyze, parentheses in parentheses, and it's just going to do the same thing as this did. We could almost take this code and just copy and paste it, but I am going to rewrite it. So we need to set those things to zero. Letters equals zero. Why? Because we may call it more than once. Digits equals zero. And then for parentheses int I equals zero, semicolon I is less than s dot length, parentheses in parentheses, semicolon I plus plus, open curly brace, char space ch equals s dot char capital A T parentheses I. Yeah, this is looking real familiar. And then we have our checks. If it's a letter, we add to the letters. If it's a digit, we add to the digits. So if capital C character dot is alphabetic, parentheses, CHN parentheses, letters plus plus, semicolon. Same for digits. If character with a capital C dot is digit, capital D, parentheses, CHN parentheses, and parentheses, digits plus plus. So that's our class. Let's add some comments. This is the end of the analyze method. And this is the end of the class. I forgot what I called it, string analysis. I'm just going to copy that and paste it in string analysis class. Just helps me keep track of where I am. Okay, after I've done my analysis, I might want to print that data out. So I'm going to write a method called displayResults. Public void. Void means it doesn't return anything. DisplayResults, parentheses in parentheses, semicolon, parentheses in parentheses, curly brace. We're just going to print those things out. System.out.println string equals space end quote plus s in parentheses semicolon system.out.println contains or letters equals space end quote plus letters in parentheses semicolon system.out.println digits equals space end quote or no comma plus digits in parentheses semicolon. All right, so we have a class we could use. We can call in main. So what is a class? It's a blueprint. It's a blueprint for a collection of data. Our data is string and then these two counters and methods, which are functions that act on that data. So we've got two methods. We've got a method called analyze and we've got a method called displayResults. We might want to add a third method to set the number of strings, or set the string value. So let's do that. Up here, we're going to create one more void. We're going to call it void space set string, capital S, parentheses, string space S in parentheses. And we're just going to say this dot S equals S semicolon. What this means is that this is known as the this reference. And it indicates that this S that follows is part of the class. And I could have been using that all along. I could have said this dot letters equals zero, this dot digits equals zero, this dot s dot length, and so on. But you only have to do that if you have two things with the same name. If you have a parameter variable and an instance variable, a class member with the same name, then you have to use this dot. But in this case, we didn't have anything else called letters or digits, so it's not strictly necessary. Okay, so down in main, let's create an example. Like string name equals, you know, I am Joe Bob the fourth, end quote, semicolon. Now let's create an analysis object. String analysis, I hope I spelled that wrong. I mean, right. I'm just going to copy and paste that. I'm paranoid that I'm not typing it right. SA for string analysis equals new string analysis parentheses in parentheses semicolon. Now let's set our data. So SA.set string parentheses name in parentheses semicolon. Now let's analyze. SA.analyze parentheses in parentheses. And then SA dot display results parentheses in parentheses, just like that. So when we run it, it will create an example of our class, an instance of our class called an object, and store reference to that object in SA, and then it will set the string, it'll call the analyze method, and it'll display the results. Now we've been using functions, excuse me, methods all along. We've been using classes all along, we just didn't really think of them in those terms, specifically the scanner class. Also the random class a little bit, I think. And there we go. It analyzed the string, Joe Bob the fourth. It found 8 letters in it, and it found 1 digit. Let's make another class. Class called Circle. Classic class. It's only got 1 piece of data in it, which is the radius. Do I need to slow down? Are y'all caught up on the typing?
I'm caught up.
You okay?
Yeah.
All right. So I'm going to go up above main, or excuse me, above public class. Now every class should go in its own file. And I tend not to do that in here. But if you wanted to be a good programmer, you would put every class in its own file. I don't really know why I don't. I guess it's just because it's easier to upload the notes if they're all in one file. You can only have 1 public class, though, in a file. And that specific class has to match the file name. All right, so class space circle, parentheses in parentheses. Nope, parentheses, sorry. Class circle, curly brace, close curly brace. It's got 1 piece of data. It's got a radius. Why not make its radius a double so we can set it equal to 10.5? So double space radius, semicolon. We're going to make a setter for the radius. Void space set radius, parentheses, double space radius, end parentheses, curly brace, this.radius equals radius, semicolon, close curly brace. Now we're going to get the area, maybe the circumference. The circumference is 2 pi r. The area is pi r squared. The diameter is just 2 times it. So we could add 3 functions to it if we wanted to go all crazy and stuff. Now these are going to return values. So double space get circumference parentheses in parentheses. Why are we not passing in any data? Because the radius is built into the class. So we're not going to pass in any data. We're going to assume that we're going to use this object's radius. So double space C equals 2 times pi times r. So 2 times math dot pi asterisk this dot radius semicolon, and then return C semicolon. I made a slight boo-boo. I would like to name all of my classes with an uppercase initial letter. So I'm going to change that lowercase c to an uppercase c. That's just a convention, but it's a very useful one. So that every single time you see an uppercase letter, you know it's a class name. That's why scanner began with a capital S and random and so on. How about get area? Double space get capital A area parentheses in parentheses curly brace double space A or area equals it's pi r squared. So math dot pi asterisk math dot POW parentheses radius comma 2 in parentheses semicolon. Or you could just do radius times radius, right, or whatever. And just to be a little more thorough than I was last time, I'm going to make it say this dot radius. Typically, I use the this reference for every single time I access any of these instance variables. Even though in the above example I did not, I in retrospect wish I had. Now that I've calculated the area, I need to return it. So the next line is return area. All right, I can go down to main and create some circles. If I'm going to set the radius, why not get the radius as well? I'm going to start adding some keywords that we haven't seen before. I'm going to make the radius private. So I'm going to add the word private there. And in front of everything else, I'm going to add the word public. So public void set radius. Public double get circumference. Public double get area. So down in main, now that I've got this class done, I'm going to create a circle and I'm going to set its radius and then I'm going to print some information out about it. So circle space C1 equals new capital C circle, parentheses in parentheses, C1 dot set radius equal to 2, or parentheses 2 in parentheses. Let's make another one. Circle C2 equals new circle capital C, parentheses in parentheses, semicolon, C2 dot set radius, parentheses 4. Now we have two circles. Let's print out their information. System.out.printf parentheses quote C1 radius equals percent F backslash N end quote comma C1 dot get radius parentheses in parentheses semicolon. I guess I never added a get radius method. That's why it's underlined. I'm going to need to fix that. But I'm going to go ahead and finish this anyways. I have two other things I could get, which are the area and the circumference. So I'm just going to copy that and paste it and make it say C1 area equals and then C1.getArea, capital A. I'm going to paste it again and make it say C1 dot circumference, and then this will be C1 dot get circumph. But I have this get radius method, this call, which is an error because it doesn't exist. I mentioned adding it, but I didn't. So I need to scroll back up to my circle class and add one more method to it. This is the end of my circle class right here. The last curly brace before the next class begins. End circle class. So public space double space get capital R radius, parentheses in parentheses, curly brace, return this dot radius, semicolon. That should fix the error down in main. So down here in main, I'm going to copy all this stuff and just change all the C1s to C2s. So I'm going to copy all that stuff, paste it, and change it to C2 radius, area, circumference, and C2 get radius, get area, and get circumference. Now when I run it, I should see some information about those circles. Right. Circle 1's radius is 2, so his area is 12 and circumference is 12. That's an odd coincidence. How's that possible? And then the radius is 4, and so its area is 50 and a circumference. Well, is that right? Is it possible for the area and the circumference of something to be the same?
No.
Right? That can't be right. What if I made this 1 and 10? Well, 2 pi r is that, pi r squared is that. Well, maybe it's correct. Let's go look at the formulas. Get circumference and get area. 2. Oh, no wonder. Why would they be the same? Let's rewrite this to math.pi times this dot radius times 2. If you pass in radius as 2, these are the same equation, right? Pi times radius times 2 is the same thing as pi times radius if radius is set to 2. So it really is true. That for a circle of radius 2, the area and the circumference are the same. Of course, 1 is in square units. I want y'all to add a method called getDiameter. I'll add some specs. It returns a double. The formula is 2 times this dot radius. That's what you need to return. All right. So public double get diameter, parentheses in parentheses, curly brace. Return 2 times this dot radius. Now what does that word public mean? Public means that it's accessible to any code. If we change it to private like this, it's not accessible to any code. It's only accessible inside the class. So since this is declared as private, these methods can get a hold of that value. Can get a hold of that variable. But main can't. If I come down here to main and I do after one of my circles, right, and say I wanted to change the radius to something, this isn't going to work. C2.radius equals 10. Doesn't work because radius is a private variable. If I wanted this to work, which I don't really, I would come up here and I would make radius public. Then when I scroll back down, I'm going to see that I can change its radius that way. But like I said, I really don't want to allow that. Why? This is called data encapsulation. Data encapsulation means that the class sets the data private and only allows access through it via the specific interface, the specific API we provide, the specific set of methods. And why would you want to do that? So you could validate the data. We might not want to let them set a radius of less than zero, or maybe even zero. Okay. Can a circle have a negative radius? No, it can't. So we could put an if statement here, right? If radius is less than zero, print an error message. You know, otherwise set the radius. So by using your setters appropriately, you could validate the data to make sure that the data in the object is always good, so you don't have to worry when you call one of the other methods that it's going to crash because of bad data. So data encapsulation is hiding the details from the calling code. The calling code doesn't need to know how the radius is stored, what format it's stored. All it needs to know is that it can set the radius and then get the area and the circumference and the diameter. I thought I already downloaded that. Object-oriented programming. That's what we're doing. We created a class, which was the blueprint for the circle object. Every circle was an instance of the circle class. So, in the old days, the standard programming technique was called procedural programming. The emphasis was on the procedures. Procedure is just a different name for a function or task that made up a program. Now, if you took a Python programming class, it was largely procedural programming. You probably didn't do much with classes. That's because the emphasis was on the procedures. You design your program around what were the key procedures. What you would think is, okay, here's what I'm going to do. I need to take some data, and I need to be able to do this, this, and this. And you'd write three procedures to do the this, this, and this. Today, the most popular programming technique is object-oriented programming. With object-oriented programming, instead of thinking first about the procedures, you think about the things in the program. Okay, it's going to need to do three things, but what is it doing those three things to? Well, it's doing it to a file, and to a report, and to a set of data. So you could create an object that held the file, or the file name, and the report name, and the set of data. And so those things in your problem are the objects, and then to those objects, inside the classes, you define the things that they need to be able to do. They need to be able to open the file. They need to be able to calculate the area. So an object is a set of related data which identifies the current state of the object plus a set of behaviors. But I'd rather you memorize my definition, because I like my definition. A class is a blueprint for an object that is a collection of data, or you could say variables, and the actions or methods that use that data. Some people call them behaviors rather than actions or methods. In fact, I'm going to delete the word action entirely and just leave it in the methods that add that data. Yeah, I'll leave the word actions there. Why not? And then an object is an instance of a class. So like if you're going to build a custom house, right? You go and you buy some blueprints. The house blueprint is the class. And then the house that you build based on the blueprint is the object. And if you're a construction company, you might build 20 houses based on the same blueprint. So you might have 20 different objects that are the same class. We created two objects of the same class here. We only created one analysis object, but we could have created a second one, right? Don't know why we would, but we could, right? String analysis SA2 equals new string analysis parentheses in parentheses SA2 dot set string. Wow, right? Whatever. We could create as many different objects of that class as we want. The terms object and instance are synonymous. They mean the same thing. This is not the object, although it's easy to refer to it as that. Yeah, that's the string analysis object. C1 is a circle object, but it's not really. It's a reference to an object. Because if you turn around and do this, down here at the bottom, C2 equals C1. Now you only have one object. What do I mean by that? Well, C2 was pointing to an object, but then we reassigned it to point at the first object. Now they're pointing at the same area in memory. So if we change C1's radius, then when we print C2's radius out, they're going to be the same. C1.setRadius, parentheses 0, in parentheses, semicolon. And then if we system.out.println c2.getRadius, it's going to also say 0. Not because changing it changed it for both objects. There's really only one object anymore. It's just got two names. But that's true. You've got a first name and a last name. You've got two names. Or I've got two names because you could call me by my title. You could say, hey, Jeff, or you know, Professor Thompson. So we have two names. It's like two street signs pointing to the same street. Well, what happened to the C2 object? Well, nothing is pointing to it anymore, so it's called an orphaned object, right? There's no way to get a hold of what used to be the C2 object anymore because we no longer have a reference to it. So it's orphaned. It's a street with no name, if you like U2, right? You know, there's no way to find it. There's no reference to it, so the so-called garbage collector will come up and free that memory at a certain point so that we don't have to worry about it, you know, that memory not ever getting released. So let's run it. We're going to find out that C2's radius is 0, even though we set C1's radius. And it's just because of the same object. You have two street signs pointing to my house. You paint my house red. No matter what street sign you follow, you're going to see a red house. There it is. And if we called C1.getRadius, of course, it would say the same thing, 0.0. So at this point, both reference variables now point to the same object in memory. The object that C2 formerly pointed to now has no references pointing to it. So it is an orphaned object. Orphan object. The garbage collector will free that memory. Remove the object from memory so that it doesn't waste space, doesn't waste the bytes in your computer. So some people use the term reference type rather than class. Circle is a reference type. String analysis is a reference type. Scanner is a reference type. Random is a reference type. All of those are reference types. All of those are classes. Why are they called reference types? Because they create a reference variable. This creates a reference variable called C1 that contains a pointer, a reference to a circle. The new keyword creates a new instance of the circle class, a reference, and it returns its reference to that. So, sample objects. You could have employees. You could have customers. You could have students. You could have a class called student. Cars that are in a traffic flow simulation. Aircraft in an air traffic control simulator. Electrical components in a design program. Points in a coordinate system like X, Y, or X, Y, and Z. Complex numbers, time, number of hours, number of minutes, you know, the date. So your object has data and methods that act on that data, and the program uses it by calling the methods. So a class is a description for a set of objects. Each computer has different specifications.
Excuse me.
They have a size and a color, bless you. And who knows what else they have, you know, different hard drive sizes or different processors or whatever. So the class is a description for a set of objects, which is a list of variables and a list of methods. I said it was a template for an object that consists of data and methods, same thing. Classes can define two types of variables, instance variables and class variables. We're going to ignore class variables right now, but class variables are the ones that have the word static in front of them. We're just going to not worry about that right now. For now, we're not going to create any static variables unless on the slim chance we wanted to put them in our main class, right? If our main method needs to access a variable that's also inside the same class, it had also better be declared as static, because a static method can only call other static methods when they're in the same class. So these are instance variables because they change on an instance by instance basis. Each string analyzer can contain a separate string. Each circle can contain a separate radius. So each instance of the circle class can have a different radius. One might have a radius of one, one might have two, one might have four, one might have 10. So a class's instance variables specifies the type of data that it can store. Our circle can store a double representing radius. Our string analyzer can contain a string. Our computer objects that we see on this slide might include a hard disk size instance variable. And then we might add some methods that specify the behavior that the object can exhibit. That's a silly way of putting it, but every computer might have a method that allows you to print its specifications. That's one of the behaviors. I don't like the term behavior, but whatever. It's one of the actions you can do with a computer object is you can print its specifications. That might print the computer's hard disk size and its CPU and its cost and so on. So we could define a computer class that had these things. So somewhere after the end of our circle class, class computer, and it's got a hard disk size. I guess nowadays you have hard disks that contain, like, you know, things much larger than 2 billion, so we might want to define it as long. So disk space or disk storage, right? And then long memory, you know, in bytes. And then some string representing the model name. And so on. And what might you want to do with the computer? You might want to be able to specify its storage. Oh, and of course, price. Double space price. That'd be an example. We might make an employee class. Class employee. Every employee has a name or a first name. So string space first underscore name semicolon. String last underscore name semicolon. And a birth date. String space birth underscore date. And a hiring date. Right, when they were hired, and then a termination date. String hire underscore date, semicolon. String fire date. Nah, we're not going to call that, but termination underscore date, semicolon. And then their address and their employee ID number and their social security number or whatever. You know, their pay rate, number of hours they work per week, or, you know, if they're a salaried employee, their annual salary or whatever, right? So, int space monthly underscore salary, like that. Every employee could have a different first name and last name and birth date. These are all instance variables. And then we might have a method called print paycheck, right? Or hire employee, you know, or terminate employee. Set insurance, whatever. There's no insurance data here, but there could be. I did start the recorder again, did I not? Good. So note the use of the term instance and instance variable and instance method reinforces the fact that instance variables and methods are associated with a particular object instance. Each employee is an instance of the employee class. Each circle is an instance of the circle class. Each computer object could have its own hard disk size. So UML stands for Unified Modeling Language. It's a way of specifying information about a class. So for example, I'm going to fire up Notepad, and I'm going to create a UML for my circle. So I'm just going to put, you know, a bunch of hyphens, meaning that's the top section. The class name is circle. That goes in the first box. The second box is a list of data. The circle had a radius, which was an int. Can I type? That's the second box. List of variables. The third box is a list of methods. We had several of them. We had one. Now I put a minus sign there. That's because it's private. Plus means that it's public. So we had one called set radius that took a variable called radius that was a double, and it returned of type void. This UML shows returning nothing if it's a void, but I don't mind saying that it's a void. It also had one called get radius. So get radius did not accept any variables, if you recall. It did not have any parameter variables defined, but it did return something. It returned a double. And then we had get area, which returned a double but didn't accept any parameters. And we had one called get circumference, which returned a double. And we had one called get the one that I had y'all do, diameter. And then one more row of dashes. That's a UML diagram. And we could make one up for the string analyzer as well, but that ought to prove the point. So your homework assignment is going to be to do something a little bit different, but not too different. You're going to make a rectangle class. It's going to have two pieces of data, not just one. I'm going to sketch out the UML for it. So the name of the class is rectangle. It's got two instance variables. They're going to be private. It's going to have a height, which is a double. And it's going to have a width, which is a double. And just remember, the minus sign means private. Guess we should put that somewhere. Plus means public. Minus means private. And then you're going to have two variables that set, two methods that set those, and two methods that get those. So set height takes a variable called height, which is a double, and it returns a void. Set width accepts a variable named width of type double. It's also void because when you're setting something, you don't need a return value. Now get width does need to return a value. So get height, nothing between the parentheses. It doesn't accept any parameters, but it does return something. It returns a double. And get width doesn't take any parameters, but it returns a double. And we're going to return two things. We're going to recalculate the area. And the area is just the width times the height. And get the perimeter. So implement the above UML. See our circle class in our notes. And compare to the circle UML for help. Formulas. The area is equal to the height times the width, and the perimeter is equal to 2 times the height plus 2 times the width. Do not add instance variables for area and perimeter. What do I mean by that? Well, back here in our circle class, we did not add a variable called area, right? We did not add a variable called circumference. We did not add a variable called diameter. Why? Because if you change the radius, those values would no longer be valid, right? If we called get area, but then we turned around and we just set the radius equal to 20 million, well, whatever the area variable used to be set to is now invalid. So if something is a calculation based on a value of an instance variable, don't define that as a variable yourself. Just calculate it each time. So we're not going to store area and perimeter in variables up here. Instead, we're just going to implement getters for them. You would never call set area. I'm going to set the area of my rectangle. No, you set its height and hit width, and then get the area. Okay, so have your code create two rectangles and print information about them, the perimeter and the area. That makes sense. Yikes, we're done too early. Better keep lecturing. Up to the last minute. All right, I'm going to wind up copying and pasting this into the Java file. So here's a UML for a class called mouse. The things that they want to track in the mouse, the data. Every mouse has an age, every mouse has a weight, and every mouse has a growth rate. So each time the mouse grows, it gets a day older, and it gets a little bit heavier. And how much it gets heavier is based on its percent growth rate. So it has some operations. Ooh, they were calling them behaviors a minute ago. Now they're calling them operations. They're methods. It has three methods that act on it. You can set the percent growth rate. You want it to grow 100% each time? Great. You can call the grow method, which ages it a day. And then you can call the display method. The display method prints information. It'll print the thing's age and its weight. And so here's a class for it. The mouse class has got an age and a weight and a growth rate. It initializes them all to, you know, its age is 0, it starts off weighing 1 gram or 1 ounce or whatever that is, and its percent growth rate. They don't initialize it, but if you don't initialize an instance variable, it gets set to 0. So it starts off with a 0 growth rate. But then they provide a method called set percent growth rate. And this should look very familiar to our syntax. This dot percent growth rate equals percent growth rate, right? Just like we did this dot radius equals radius. And then grow grows it one day. So this dot weight equals the percent growth rate times this dot weight, right? It grows a little bit each day. And it adds one to the day. So its age increases by one. And then a method called display to print out information about the age and the weight, right? This mouse has an age of whatever and its weight is whatever. If we had a little bit more time, we'd actually type this in. So private and public, we've talked about that. These are access modifiers. If you leave them off, it defaults to something that's almost public, but not quite. It's public to anything in the same package. So if you apply an access modifier to a member of the class, you determine, it says how easy it is for the member to be accessed. It's not how easy, it's where it can be accessed. A private variable can only be accessed inside that class. Radius is defined as private, so only that class can access it. If we changed it to public, then main would be able to change the radius by accessing it directly, you know, c1.radius. Instead, the method is public, so you can call c1.setRadius. If you declare a member to be private, it can only be accessed from within the member class. Instance variables are usually declared private. So we're going to add one more thing to our lecture notes. Professor's recommendations of classes. So, one, class name begins with an uppercase letter. Two, every class should go in its own file, but since I break that rule in here, I'm not going to list it. All data should be made private. Three, methods should probably be public. Unless the client code isn't supposed to be able to call it. But I'm going to leave that alone and say data should be private, methods should be public. That's enough now, but we're going to add some more to these guidelines at a later point. Next time we talk. All right, let's stop. Need to open up the chapter quiz for the last chapter. Let's do that.